intentional this morning and doing things the hard way. but my CD burner did not want to work, and so I'm going to be playing the song directly from my computer. So if you'll just be patient with that, I would really appreciate it. And I hope that regardless, that this won't be a distraction and that the words will reach your heart.
Life can be so hard, never knowing what each day will bring to where you are. And sometimes I forget, sometimes I can't see that whatever comes my way, you'll be.
Amen. Mm-hmm. nice to see some sunshine. Well, as you said, my name is Marcus Harden, and it's my wife, Amanda Harden, and my brother, Caleb Harden. Some of you may know my dad, Stephen Harden, who has helped with some satellite dishes in this area. He has a hobby of helping people get 3ABN and Hope TV and such. Definitely enjoys that. And maybe some of you may know my grandpa, Dr. Hal Harden, in Wenatchee, who took over Dr. Bolton's practice. Maybe you know him as well. But Marcia, I know, I walked in the door this morning, and I used to go door to door with her a bit as a Bible worker when I worked for the Valley View Church and a couple other churches in the area. And so that's kind of where I've been, and some people I know and related to. And currently I work at Colonial Vista in Wenatchee as a restorative CNA. And I help people do exercise and maintain their abilities to do different, just basic functions, and also hopefully improve them as well. But let's start with a word of prayer before we get into the message. Dear Lord, I thank you for this wonderful Sabbath day where we have an opportunity to gather together as fellow Christians who look to you, Lord, and I just pray that you'll be with me this morning, that you'll bless the words that I speak, that they might only be your words, and that we each might be drawn nearer to you. In your name, amen. Amen. Well, I find that oftentimes when I go about writing a sermon or sharing any kind of Bible study message, oftentimes it's somewhat related to my life and maybe sometimes pointed at me and I need to learn this. But this morning I'm going to share some of the things I've been learning in my life, especially recently. And the message, title of the message today is As He Calls. And the scripture there was in 1 Samuel 3:10. It talked about where Samuel heard God speaking to him. God was saying, Samuel, Samuel. And a few verses before that, it was talking about how Samuel kept going to Eli, the priest, and saying, you know, hey, I'm here, you know. And Eli eventually realized that it was actually God speaking to Samuel. And so the last time Samuel said, here I am, you know, Lord, speak. And God spoke to Samuel and gave him something to do, something in his life to share. And I want you guys to imagine with me maybe a little bit here. Imagine you have a phone call. The phone rings, right? You go and you pick up the phone and you answer and somebody says to you on the other side of the line and say, I need you to move to Uzbekistan. I don't know where Uzbekistan is, but okay. So you move. But my question for you is, once if somebody were to call you and tell you to move, or somebody were to call you and to say, you know, I need you to change jobs, would you trust them? I don't know. If it were me, I probably would be like, who in the world are you to tell me anything? You know? What do you know about my life? And if you know that much about my life and you think I need to change, there must be something a little bit odd going on here. Well, God is calling each one of us to different things in our lives. Maybe we have to make a change, or maybe God is calling us to stand firm where we are and to keep working hard in doing what He's already called us to do. Sometimes we need that encouragement. Well, today we're going to look at God's call for us. God has given each one of us a call. Each one of us have opportunities in our lives that no one else has. Each one of us are unique. And if we were not to exist, God would lose an opportunity to witness to someone. So God's call. What is God's call? I want us to turn to John chapter 10, verse 27. Gospel of John chapter 10, verse 27. There it says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them. They follow me. The last two words there, follow me, are key words. I looked up a number of passages who say that same phrase, follow me. they follow me. As we have a relationship with God, God continues to call us to follow Him. And even before we have a relationship with God, God is looking at us and saying, follow me. I have a better way. I have a better plan that you can't even imagine. Follow me. So the base thing, and everything we do, God is calling us to follow Him. And let's look at another text in Luke chapter 9, which is a good one. I really like this one because it reminds me of what I need to do daily. Luke chapter 9, verse 23. Again, this is just kind of continuing this thought. It says, then He said to them, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. God has called each one of us to follow Him. You know, He called His disciples, those fishermen, they were comfortable in their career. He said, follow me. I'm going to make you fishers of men. God called Matthew, the tax collector, who had a steady job. Sure, he was hated by the Jews, but he had a steady job. He had connections to that job. And he said, follow me. And so Matthew did. Jesus continues to call people to follow Him. In fact, He called a young rich ruler to follow Him. Unfortunately, this young rich ruler couldn't give up what he had in the wealth and the riches to follow God. Because sometimes we allow things in this life to get in the way of following God. But God, again, is continuing to ask us to follow Him in everything. And how does God ask us to follow? How does God speak to us? And, you know, there's different ways. You know, sometimes He can speak to us through nature, through songs, through His Word very much, you know, on a daily basis as we're reading His Word and as we're praying. God speaks to us also through the still small voice and through dreams sometimes. And I don't know about you, but for me, most of the time, God seems to talk to me quietly. Almost as if I almost can't hear Him, in a sense. It's through that still small voice that God speaks to me most often. Which, for me, is challenging because I want this loud, this maybe bellow from the sky. It's kind of like when John baptized Jesus and that voice from heaven. I want something like that. I want God to say, hey, Marcus, turn here. Do this. But most of the time, just like Elijah, if you remember that story where Elijah was in the wilderness and there was the fire and the quake and then the still small voice. Most of the time, God speaks. That still, small voice impresses us on what we need to do. But I have a question for you. Like if you were to answer that phone call, how do you know if what you're impressed to do is truly from God? And we looked at that text there in John chapter 10, verse 27. It says, my sheep, you know, they know me. They know my voice. They follow me. We have that relationship with God. And interestingly enough, even before we allow God to work in our hearts, somehow, built into us, we have a desire, and God can work with that. And God can help us to know that He's speaking to us, to follow Him, even before we truly have a relationship. But even when we have a relationship, we can know even more what God's voice sounds like. We can know, hey, if I'm being called to Uzbekistan, I can pray, and I can ask for God's guidance, I can read His Word, and He can give me the confidence as I move forward, because I have that relationship with Him. I continually am spending time with Him. Another text I'd like to look at is in Genesis. Genesis chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. Genesis chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. And so here, you know, God has created the world. He's created Adam and Eve, and they've spent time with Him. And here in chapter 3, they've been tempted by Satan to go away from God's plan. God had given them specific directions. and they had gone away from us. And so in chapter 3, verses 8 and 9, it says, "And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees in the garden. Then the Lord God called to Adam and said to him, 'Where are you?'" So he's in 10. He said, "I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself." So Adam heard God's voice. He knew there was God. He had spent time with God. There was no mistaking that this was God, and so he hid himself. Well, in the same sense, we can know that it's God leading us. If we spend that relationship, we can have no doubt that it's God leading us. Now, God isn't going to ask us to go jump off a cliff. God isn't going to ask us to do something that's unwise. He wants to show us that he has a plan for us and a plan for our betterment, not for something bad to happen to us. God truly will look after us, and we can trust him and know that it's him calling. Well, I don't know about you, but oftentimes, unfortunately, I second guess what I'm being impressed to do. Oftentimes I find myself being like, was that really what I need to do? Is that really what God wants me to do? You know, as a Bible worker, I remember times being impressed to talk to a person in a certain way or broach a certain subject, and I didn't do it. And as I look back on it now, I can clearly see that God was impressing me to say something to that person in such a way that it would bring him nearer to you, to him. And yet, I missed out on that opportunity. You know, I remember one time, even just talking to a guy in Kashmir, where I brought a Bible study lesson, and I was trying to talk to him. I was trying to be, you know, in some ways a salesman with the Bible study. I was trying to really get him to look at the Bible study. And I missed the opportunity to actually get to know him a bit more before I did that. Give me a greater opportunity to share that more with him. And thankfully, God used my friend Tom Steffen, if any of you know him, to meet this man where he was and to talk with him. And we really had a good conversation with him. Thanks to God for that. But it was because I could have had the opportunity. God gave me that opportunity, but I didn't allow him to lead me in that instance. Now, sometimes, you know, we doubt God in his leading, and so we miss out on job prospects or opportunities to witness to our neighbors. Sometimes, you know, it's school or different things. I know for me, that's been the case. I remember one time I was doing a lot of Bible studies. This is shortly after I grew up in the church, but I never really gave my heart fully to God until around 2008. And I had been doing Bible studies along with the Bible worker of our church, and I was working along with one of my good friends. We were doing Bible studies with people, and the Bible worker challenged me. She says to me, "You know, you should really check out this Bible work school. You should really check it out." And so I did. I started filling an application and moving in that direction and going there. But it was about $4,000 or $5,000, and I thought, there's no way. I don't have it. There's no way it can happen. And so I gave up. But I had felt strongly impressed to move forward with that, but I gave up. And I missed out on an opportunity to learn more in a better fashion of the Bible so that I could better present it. And praise God, he always has different ways of helping us learn. You know, he doesn't let us just fall and not get up. But God helped me out, and I ended up being able to get some education in that area, and I learned about the Bible more so I could present that. But I missed out on that opportunity. God is constantly calling us to trust him and to respond in a good manner. Now, it's kind of neat, though, when we do trust God, when we do trust is leading in our lives. I remember one time going door to door, and me and my pastor at the Valley View Church, Pastor Jim, we were going door to door. We were going to give a Bible study lesson to somebody who we had met the week prior. And so we knocked on the door, and nobody answered. And so we're like, you know, what do we do now? We had specifically gone to talk to this person. And my pastor, you know, I specifically wanted to go to meet this person, talk with him. And so, well, maybe we should kill some time before we go back. Maybe we should go knock on some doors and meet some people before we go back. And we ended up going back later, but they were never home. But during that time that we went door to door, we actually met someone, the last house on the street, who now is a Christian, who believes in God, and him and his wife and his daughter were all baptized, and God truly transformed his life and answered his prayer. God gave us an opportunity to do something, and when we listened to his impression, followed his lead, we had that opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it's interesting recently too for me and my wife. You know, we got married in August this last year, and so we're newlyweds and figuring out everything, and it's kind of challenging sometimes. But we thought, okay, well, you know, we need enough money to support our schooling and to support ourselves. And so Amanda was working with some kids, helping taking care of them, and I was working at a facility where we worked with people who had dementia. And we were working really hard, and yet we really didn't see each other much. I went to work at 6 and got back at about 2, and Amanda left to work at 1 and got back around 5, and then after that we were going to classes and we didn't see each other much, and our marriage wasn't going so well. And God was really impressing and working upon both of us to make some changes. And so Amanda was a little more persistent on it. She wanted to stay home and focus on school and spend time taking care of the house. And I was like, you know, I can't do that. We can't do that. We don't have enough money that we can do that. You know, and I'm so stressed out as is. I don't think we can do that. And so Amanda kind of persists a little bit, but she learned that the more she pushes, the more I get stubborn. So it's kind of sad sometimes, but it's the way it is. And so she kind of let off, and we just kind of prayed about it and let God lead. And so I prayed about it some more, and in February this year, I started to apply to some different jobs, and I was kind of like, okay, so we're going to need income, you know, you have to have money to live, that's reality, that's life. And I said, well, you know, first of all, my job right now currently is stressful, and I can't deal with that, I can't deal with working more hours there, it's just not going to work. And so I went looking for more jobs, and it ended up that the day that I made a full commitment to allow and tell Amanda, I said, Amanda, you can stay home. When I made that full commitment, that same day, and in fact, right after we got done praying about that and committing that to the Lord, I got a phone call. And a friend of mine, Connie McKay, who works at Clona Vista, called me up and said, hey, Marcus, I got your application from Mark, the administrator, and I'd like to offer the job to you. And I was ecstatic. In fact, it was the job pays more, and it's better hours, and it's less stressful. And so, you know, we moved forward then, and God provided that job. But that's not to say that it isn't hard sometimes, because shortly after that, my hours got cut, and we were getting a little scared there, you know, okay, what's going to happen? But, okay, God's got it. And so God helped provide for that.
Amen.
Another thing recently for me that has been a challenge is I'm looking at going to college this fall. And, you know, it's not cheap. Not cheap at all. I know my dad always tells me, he says, Marcus, I worked and I paid off all my college, and it was, I think, like 10 grand or something like that. And I'm like, Dad, it's at least double that, and it's harder to earn the money. And he's like, well, I know you can do it, but I've been going to school and I know what it is. And so I was like, I don't know, you know, how is this going to work out? But I felt impressed that, we both felt impressed that we need to make a move. And so I put in my application to Southern Adventist University and got accepted, and okay, that's great, but that doesn't mean there's money. You know, just because I accepted doesn't mean there's any money. And so we continue to move forward. Continue to pray about it, continue to ask God's guidance in that, and trusted that God was truly calling us there, because we had heard His voice, we knew He was calling us. And then, sure enough, I got my financial award letter, and almost, like over half of it, probably 60-70% of it, was paid for already. And right now, I'm only going to have to pay like $3,000 worth of that $20-something thousand, mm-hmm. because God's provided every little bit that I need to go to school. You know, when God's calling, He wants us to respond in a manner that's positive and trusting Him and following Him, because He has a plan.
Amen.
But it takes us moving forward, because like with a job and stepping out and having a man to stay home, I had to move forward. Then I got the call. With college, I had to move forward, make plans, and let trust that God was leading me there. And then the money was provided. Mm-hmm. God wants us to trust Him. Well, there's some Bible characters in Hebrews chapter 11, let's look at there really quick, who God called to do different things. So Hebrews chapter 11, wonderful, wonderful chapter in the Bible. But we'll just kind of briefly look through this. And Hebrews chapter 11 is known as the faith chapter of the Bible, of course. Many of us know that. And it's a wonderful chapter of the Bible. And the first kind of character there we see is in verse 4, Abel. God called Abel to make a sacrifice of a lamb, which represented, of course, Jesus, you know, in the New Testament, called him to do this. And so Abel did it. Abel followed God's calling and did it. And he died for it. Mm-hmm. The next person there in verse 5, Enoch. God called Enoch to trust Him and to follow Him. And so Enoch walked with God. And so then it says there in verse 5 that he was not to be found because he did not see death. God had taken him. Mm-hmm. Enoch followed God's calling, and God took him to heaven. And he didn't die. Mm-hmm. And then Noah, in verse 7, God called Noah to preach the fact that there was going to be a flood, and to preach repentance, and called him to build an ark. And so Noah built an ark. And then Abraham there in verse 8 there, you know, Abraham, God called Abraham to move to a foreign land. And so Abraham did. He trusted God. By faith, he trusted God. Now, it's not to say that these people were perfect. You know, with Abraham, he definitely made some mistakes along the way, and God helped him to get back up from those.
Amen.
Helped him to proceed forward and not to keep down in that sin. And then you just continue there. You've got Abraham with Jacob. You got Moses. You've got Rahab there at Jericho, who trusted and followed God's calling. Each one of these people are examples for us. You know, God has different callings on us. You know, it may not be to move. It may not be to change jobs. But God has a calling for our lives.
Amen.
And it's interesting too, we each have an opportunity every day to follow God's calling. You know, God can impress us in our lives to do simple little things. You know, that song we sang for opening song talked about kind of some of the words that we can speak to someone. And it's been neat. As I've worked in my current job, I've kind of missed Bible work. You know, you enjoy being in ministry full-time and being out there and constantly involved in giving Bible studies and stuff, and I really missed that. But God has continued to give me opportunities to be a witness. And it was neat. One day, I was working with a resident. We were going to do some arm exercises and some walking. And this resident was really down. She's got dementia, but not so much that she doesn't realize that it's happening to her. She was really down that she realized that she was losing her mind and she couldn't remember things. And she was getting really disheartened, and she was saying to me, she says, "Marcus, God's cursed me. God is angry with me for the way I've led my life." And I said, no. I said, "No, God loves you. God loves you so much. It's because of the sin in this world that you're going through what you're going through. But God loves you and has a plan for you." Mm-hmm. And I had the opportunity to share that with her, and as she had tears coming down her cheeks, we prayed together and thanked God for the plan that she had for her, even though she was there in Colonial Vista, not able to do much, you know, losing her memory, her mind. And I had another opportunity just this, not this week, but last week. I have a resident that I work with on a daily basis who had a stroke. And, you know, she's not able to use part of her body very well, not able to speak very well. But it was so neat. We were working together, and I was working with her arm and doing some range of motion and kind of loosening up her hand a little bit, had been clenched. And we were talking a little bit, just as much as we could. I was mostly talking because she wasn't able to talk too well at all. And she started singing as best she could a song that we all know, "Jesus Loves Me, This I Know, For the Bible Tells Me So." What an opportunity. Okay, I know that song, and so I started singing along with her. We sang "Jesus Loves Me," we sang parts of the old "Rugged Cross," "Amazing Grace" together. God gave me an opportunity, as He called me, to be a witness to this lady, to be an encouragement to this lady. God has given each one of us opportunities. It doesn't matter where we are. It doesn't matter what we're doing, to follow His calling, to reach others for Him, to follow Him. There's a neat story there in Acts. Acts chapter 16. One of my favorite. I don't know if you guys have heard of Generation Youth for Christ. I used to be General Youth Conference. And my wife and I went to it back in the end of December in Seattle, Washington. And there's probably, 4,000 to 8,000 people, I think, at least, that go there. Just a wonderful gathering of youth, young people. A lot of great speakers. And one of the messages that was presented was, all the messages were presented through Acts. And one of the messages talked a little bit about Acts chapter 16, starting at verse 6 there, the Macedonian call. And it's one of my favorite. It says there, "Now when they had gone through Phrygia and the region of Galatia, they were forbidden by the Holy Spirit to preach the word in Asia. After they had come to Mysia, they tried to go in Bithynia, but the Spirit did not permit them. So passing by Mysia, they came down to Troas." I don't know about you, but sometimes when I try to do things to follow God, it gets a little discouraging. It seems like doors slam in my face, and I can't move forward. Well, God had a plan here. You know, they kept trying to do different things, but the Holy Spirit was not permitting them to do that. And so, in verse 9, it says, "A vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man of Macedonia stood and pleaded with him, saying, 'Come over to Macedonia and help us.' Now after he had seen the vision, immediately he sought to go to Macedonia, concluding the Lord had called us to preach the gospel to them." God gave Paul a calling to go to Macedonia through a vision. That's pretty neat. And they went there and they had a great opportunity to be witnesses for God. As we read through the book of Acts, we read many stories like this, where God called different of the disciples, to work for him and to build up the church so it could be strong for him.
Mm-hmm.
We read about it now, it's such an encouragement to me because, you know, even now, we are called to go around the world with God's message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that he is coming again, that he loves us and cares for us. We are called to do that now. And he can work just like he did then. What an encouragement.
Amen.
So God provides for us whenever we respond to his call, trusting in him that he will lead. Another story I like is in Acts chapter 10. I love stories. That's probably my favorite part of the Bible, is the stories in the Bible. Acts chapter 10 talks about a man named Cornelius. It says, Acts chapter 10, verse 1, it says, there was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of what was called the Italian regiment. And it goes on and talks about how an angel came to Cornelius, a man who was trusting God and following God the best he knew at that time. An angel came to him and said, Cornelius, send for Simon, whose surname is Peter. Send for him. And he gave him directions of where to go. And so Cornelius followed God's call through this angel and sent people to go find Simon. Well, while that was happening, of course, we know that starting in verse 9 through 16, that Peter was having a vision at that time that was helping him to be prepared for when Cornelius's delegation came to him. And so there in verse 17, Peter says, now while Peter wondered within himself what this vision which he had seen meant, behold, the man who had been sent from Cornelius had made inquiry for Simon's house and stood before the gate. And God directs Peter to go with these men. And as you read, there's an amazing story of how these Gentiles came to know Jesus Christ and were actually baptized.
Amen.
And God called Cornelius to send the people to go. God called Peter to go and meet with these people. And God did an amazing work there. When we follow God's call, he provides amazing blessings far beyond we can even imagine. And it could be a small calling. It could be a big calling, but they're all going to end up with an amazing reward in heaven.
Amen.
I'm looking forward to that. I don't know about you guys, but I am looking forward to heaven.
Amen.
What an amazing place. Amazing place where there's no more theft, no more dying, no more cruelty of any kind. We keep track of there's a website on the internet that called YouTube, and there's a person on there who posts videos. And these videos every month show different news clips around the world. And like Dan was saying, this world is falling apart. But Jesus is coming.
Amen.
And as we follow his call every day in the small things or the big things, he will help us.
Mm-hmm.
There was an interesting story that was shared in Sabbath School. I just really appreciated there about a man here who had become a new Christian. I forget your name. I think it's Ralph.
Ralph.
I really appreciated that. And he followed God's guidance as he'd been picked up by this man who was driving along, and this man was up to no good. And he followed God's guidance and was able to witness to this man. You know, God has a calling for our life all the time. Everything. You know, God may be calling you to go make banana bread for your neighbor. And we did that. And we had a wonderful time doing that. Just last night, it's been a few weeks now since we did that. Just last night, one of the guys said to me as I was walking down to get our laundry, and he says to me, man, that banana bread was so good. Thank you so much for that. And then I was walking off, and he was telling his friends, man, they made such good banana bread. It was amazing. God gives us little opportunities all the time. It doesn't take much. We don't have to give a Bible study or a sermon. We don't have to preach an evangelistic series. We can do little things. We can smile at people.
Mm-hmm.
We can pray with people. We can give them a bread or food or these different things. God gives us opportunities. God calls us to these different actions. And as we follow His calling, He provides amazing things that will just blow our mind, that we can't even comprehend. There's a text in Ezekiel chapter 34, which has a song attached to it. Ezekiel 34:26. Let me just go there really quick. Just recently read this, and I like this text. So 34, verse 26 of Ezekiel. I will make them in all places around in my hill, all around my hill, a blessing, and I will cause showers to come down in their season. There shall be showers of blessing. As we allow God to work in our lives, there will be showers of blessings, not only in our lives, but the lives around us. And really, honestly, for me, that's what's more important. The lives around me is more important than my life. I have a relationship with God, and I know God's working, and I know He'll bless me, but I want blessings to come on the people around me so that they can be in the kingdom too.
Amen.
I mean, can you imagine? There's a passage in Spirit of Prophecy which talks about people at the end of time who will come to different people who have known about the truth of the gospel and God's word and say, you knew about this, but you didn't tell me. You knew about this, but you didn't tell me. And I remember a fellow Bible worker standing up front one time sharing a report about where her boyfriend at the time, as they were discovering the truth, said to her, you knew about this, but you didn't tell me. Mm-hmm. And she was just crying. How could I ever have done this? God has called us to preach the gospel in actions, in word, in deed. God is calling us constantly, every day, to witness. And God is calling us to respond in faith, trusting in His leading, trusting that He'll provide, even if it seems to be very challenging, even if it seems to be that there is no wide path opened up before us. Mm-hmm. God will provide. And God is calling each one of us today. Each one of us here coming to this church is a witness to this community of, hey, there is people who go to church on a Sabbath day to spend time with their Lord and Savior, who desire to have a close walk with God, who love God. And as we go from here, we can be a little lights. As that song says, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. We can go up here and let a little light shine in the community here. God is calling each one of us to follow His calling and to trust in Him. If you want to be a part of that, and trusting God's calling, and believing that He will provide, even when it's challenging, I ask you to stand with me as we sing our closing song, number 691, I believe it is.
Mm-hmm.
Lead me, Lord.